Welcome. Let's begin with the last chapter for class 11 geography. Today we would be talking about biodiversity and conservation. Now when we talk about biodiversity and conservation, let's understand some of the important things as to why do we need biodiversity and why biodiversity has been ever changing. We say with evolution, we have nearly a history of 2.5 million to 3 million years, and over those periods we have witnessed more than 1 to 4 million species. 99% of the species that were there are no more there, so they are totally extinct. There has been a constant variability and a dynamics in the species, the ecosystem that have remained over the period of years. This ecosystem or this diversity in the ecosystem could be understood with various approaches. So there are three types of diversities that we talk about. The first is the genetic diversity. This occurs within our genes. So within our systems, we have a diversity. So my DNA would vary from my sister's DNA and so on and so forth. This makes it clear that within the Homo sapien species, there is diversity that exists, and this diversity brings about changes, and this is indeed required for a healthy breeding or a healthy generations to come. The next is species diversity, which says that there is diversity within the species, or there are different species that exist on Earth. Similarly, we have ecosystem diversity, which explains that there are different habitat, different ecological systems and processes that exist within the Earth system. Why all these biodiversity types that we have studied are important? We can simply put up, they are important because of three reasons. It could be a scientific reason, an economic reason, or an ecological reason. Scientific reason could be how the species have evolved over the time, how the functions have changed, how the role of the species have changed. When it comes to economic, we talk about all the economic pursuits. So we talk about the cosmetic industry, medicinal values, pharma industry, agricultural crops, industrial production, mining activities that could be associated to these areas, and so on and so forth. When it comes to ecological role, we talk about how the climates have changed, how the decomposition have taken place, how energy and matter have been stored. So higher we go with the variety of species, there is a higher stability into the atmospheric system or the ecosystem, we could say. So this ecosystem attains a much major, I would say, stable role as we move higher in terms of the variety of species that exist and in terms of the stability of the species that exist. The next is the loss of biodiversity. I can simply put up, there are two ways, the natural and the anthropogenic ways. Natural ways could be a flood, a drought, a forest fire, a volcanic activity, or earthquake activity. What could be the anthropogenic ways? I can say rapid rise in the population, higher consumption of resources that could take place. Again, there could be pesticides, pollutants, all of those are anthropogenic or caused by human beings. One very important cause that human beings lead to is exotic species. We introduce a new species that was not part of that biodiversity or that system, and because this new species is now introduced, there could be two ways. It could survive, it could not survive, it could invade the existing species. It could be harmful to the existing species. So that's the kind of diversity that we take place. If we look onto the Earth map, we have 0° equator, and then we have the regions of the tropics surrounding the equator. This region of the tropic accounts for 1/4 of the area, but 3/4 of the population and 50% of the species that exist globally. IUCN, or International Union for Conservation of Nature, had laid down a classification. This classification talks about the evaluated species versus the species that not have been evaluated. Then we talk about the species on which we have adequate data versus the species on which we do not have other data, which is data deficient. So we talk about the species based on the extinction rate. Least concern are those species which are abundantly available. We don't care about those. For example, pigeon, you can see a lots of pigeons around. Near threatened are those which are on the verge of being threatened. This threatened could be of three categories: vulnerable towards the extinction, Then you have endangered and critically endangered, which are very few left in number. For example, we have critically endangered snow leopards, we have endangered red panda, we have vulnerable species which are towards the risk of being endangered. Similarly, all these three are threatened and fall under the red data list of the IUCN classification. Then we have the extinct species. The extinct species are, for example, the dodo birds, which are no more present. And extinct in the wild means they are no more present in the wild. The only few species that you can see is in captivity. The next is this IUCN classification we have already talked about. The rare species is important. Rare species are those species which are present only in the specific areas. There is very less population that is seen. So, Humboldtia bed is one of the rare species found in southwestern Ghats in India. So, those are the kind of rare species. Now, when we have talked about the biodiversity, the loss of biodiversity, definitely we are working towards conserving those. So, how can we conserve those? We can have sustainable use of the resources. We can have international community that could come forward. Human awareness, human mass campaign could be part of it. Cooperation among the people. So, we had a convention of biodiversity that was signed in the Earth Summit Rio de Janeiro in 1992. Under this, we talked about conserving the extinction of the species, preserving the species, identifying the individual habitats, safeguarding the habitats, and regulating the trade of the various organisms, the plants and the animals. Similarly, we had the Wildlife Protection Act that came in 1972 in India. Under this, we established numerous national parks, wildlife sanctuary, biosphere reserves. When it comes to biosphere reserves, it's very interesting. So far, we have 18 biosphere reserves. Biosphere reserves have three areas: the core area, the buffer area, and the transition area. This core area is the area where you have no human activity that's allowed. Buffer area, you have research and development, and transition, you have human activity like hunting, and that's allowed. So, this biosphere reserves, the first one was Nilgiris that was established, spread across three areas. The largest in terms of area is the Great Run of Kutch. The most recent one is the Kanchenjunga in Sikkim. Then you also have some of the new ones like Panna, Seshasalam, Agastamalai, which are important biosphere reserves in India. The next is biodiversity hotspots. Now, what are hotspots? As you can see here, the regions marked in green are the hotspot regions. We have identified 12 such hotspot regions across the world. Madagascar, which you can see here where the pointer is, you have the highest species endemic characteristics that's found. That means 85% of the species that are present in Madagascar are not found anywhere across the globe. The people here are very, very poor, and most of the activity is agriculture and slash and burn cultivation that is seen. That's a shifting cultivation, the other name for it. Again, these biodiversity hotspots are the areas which are rich in vegetation. So, natural vegetation, abundant natural vegetation, lot of primary productivity, food, timber, grasses that could be seen. Similarly, you have Hawaii region here. This Hawaii region is the region where you have new introductory species that are coming up. So, there has been a check to curb on to the introduction of new species coming up in these areas. Similarly, in India, we have the Western Ghats. We have the northeast part of India, and a lot of region of Indonesian island group is a part of biodiversity hotspot, which are unique in their characteristics, and many of the species are endemic to the specific region. So with this, we finish our class 11 geography. The last chapter will be continuing with many more topics. So stay tuned, do subscribe, have a wonderful day ahead.